Good morning. Well, happy 4th of July, and you're all looking really good, red and blue this morning, and if I still wasn't living out of boxes and waiting to move, I would have joined you in something festive, but this was as good as I can get right now, so I hope you're having a good 4th of July weekend, going to spend some time with maybe family or friends today. That'll be great. I was told to come up and do a welcome and announcements, but there really aren't announcements other than next week Bible school starts, right? Not this week, but July 11th. So get your preparations done for that if you got anybody in your household headed that way. And again, Lisa and I are really excited, and I'm Jon Exman, in case you don't know. I'm your preacher if you weren't here last week. And we're really excited to be here with you, and so don't think that we're not moving because we don't want to live here in your town. We desperately do, so say a prayer that that happens again, because I don't think we can take much longer. but Kathy wanted to come up here, and Joe.
Good morning. We just want to do something well, the first thing I want to say is, and I'll date myself a little bit too, just how many people remember Reader's Digest? Yeah, right? There was always a story like drama in real life, there'd be some exciting story, and there was always something called laughter is the best medicine, right?
Yeah.
So this is kind of my little laughter is the best medicine situation. So as Pastor John said, it's just been a little bit of a ordeal. I think, you know, he hasn't moved yet officially, hasn't closed on a house and been living out of boxes and stuff. So we as staff parish in preparation wanted to come up with a housewarming gift. One problem, there's no house. So we thought, well, this week could be okay. Well, again, no house. So, you know, we thought, well, okay, better now than never. So in lieu of all that, staff parish, on behalf of the church, just want to present you, John, Elise, and your family just some gifts of some local things in the area. And, you know, staff parish, especially Kay Stubbins, did a great job. I can't tell you everything that's in there, but I can tell you there's potato chips from Conn's. There's, I think, a gift certificate from Tom's Ice Cream, some candy, I think something from Donald's Donuts, right? Some pottery and things like that. So eventually, when you do get moved in, these are things you can share in your house. And again, remember, laughter is the best medicine. So thank you.
I'm trying. Thank you very much. And we really appreciate it. Thank you. Appreciate all the things that you guys have been doing. Thanks, Kathy.
Thank you.
could join me in the Affirmation of Faith, the Apostles' Creed, and you can find this in your hymnal on page 881. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Well, I'm doing children's moments this morning. I don't know if there's any kiddos out there that would like to come down. You can come down, sit a little bit closer if you would like. But this is a children's moments for all of us that are young at heart. So I got to thinking about the fact that we are actually in church on the 4th of July, and as I can see, many of you are dressed up in your red, white, and blue. And so this morning, I want to talk about those three colors just a little bit. At the front of our sanctuary, we have two flags, the American flag and the Christian flag, and they are both red, white, and blue. Now, in the American flag, there are some pretty traditional meanings for those colors. The red standing for the courage of the men and women that have fought for this country, some giving the ultimate sacrifice on behalf of each and every one of us. The white standing for purity, which means that, you know, as a country, we really try to do what's right. And within each one of us, that is something that we strive for as patriotic citizens. The blue stands for justice. When we pledge allegiance to the flag, we end it with the words, with liberty and justice for all. That means that in our country, everyone is to be treated fairly and with respect. But in the Christian flag, those colors might have a little bit of a different meaning. So when you think of those colors in that context, for me, the red reminds me of the blood that Jesus shed for each one of us when he died on that cross, which is represented on the flag. That is, as in Hebrews 9:22, without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. And so the red in the Christian flag is to represent the blood that Christ shed in order that we would have that forgiveness. The white reminds me of when you give your heart to Jesus, he washes you as white as snow, as it says in Isaiah 1:18, you were washed and you were sanctified and you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the blue reminds me of God's faithfulness. Now, sometimes I think of the blue in terms of water and ocean and water, so it could be a reminder of your baptism, or it can be a reminder of the heavens, and I think that's true for both flags. But that God is faithful and that he always keeps his promises. So no matter what the red, white, and blue stands for in each flag, each of the flags, when you look at them in total, can represent all of that. We live in a land of freedom that we're afforded the incredible opportunity to come together and worship. So as we look at the American flag, that encompasses all of that. And when we look at the Christian flag and we realize the sacrifice that Christ made for each one of us, it reminds me also of the sacrifices that the men and women of our country have given for each of us to be able to live in this free land. So, as I end Children's Moments this morning, I ask you to rise and let us say the Pledge of Allegiance together and the pledge to the Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one fellowship uniting all Christians in service and love. Amen.
If we could join in the prayer hymn, Break Thou the Bread of Life, just verse 1, and you can find this on page 599 in your hymnal.
We come to a moment in time of prayer this morning. Before we have a silent prayer, are there any prayer requests that we need to be updated on or be shared this morning? Yes. Okay. Lou Ann passed away? Is that what you said? All right. Thank you for sharing that. Any others? Yes. Sister and granddaughter in prayer. Okay. Thank you. Any others? All right. We can take just a moment, and those that were verbally shared this morning, you can remember those that are listed there in the prayer list in your bulletin, and we'll take just a moment to pray to God silently. Father, we come before you this morning. We share those joys and concerns that are in our life. The hardness of burying someone that we love and that we care for and saying goodbye, as well as those struggling, Father, with their health and illness and surgeries, all the things that happen to us as we live life. And Father, also on this beautiful 4th of July, we take just a moment to remember that we live in a country like no other, where freedom rings free. Freedom to choose, freedom to be who and what we want. So many try to take that away from us, But we give that to you, God, because we know that your love for us is forever. And if we follow you and believe in you, our love for you will be eternal. And we thank you for all those who have served and given of themselves their time and their energy in our military, those among our town and church and community that are still serving. We remember them. And we remember all those who've given their life so that we can be here on this day and pray and worship you. And we do that this morning as we pray the prayer that your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hello. Microphones are not my friend.
Last time we sang in front of these folks, we had to stand 6 feet apart, take a mask off, and sing into plexiglass. So this is kind of a little celebration of freedom.
It is.
I have had to adjust my spending habits, however.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, thanks to mask and social distancing, for a little over a year, I didn't have to buy mouthwash or deodorant.
Oh. You know what? I didn't have to put on any makeup either. Things are happening.
We are going to celebrate our freedoms with our medley today, and you'll have a chance to participate. When we go get to God Bless America, we'll do it through once, and then I'll give you the motion, and you can stand up and join us on the chorus the second time through. Okay?
You know what, Kenny? I've been hearing for years that they sing with us all the way through all the time anyway.
A lot of them do. Yeah, they were even doing it when we were practicing earlier.
That's true. So. Just jump okay, right yeah. in.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. He died to make men holy. is my song. O God of all the nations, a song of peace for lands afar and wide. This is my home, the country where my heart is. While the storm clouds gather far across the sea,
let us swear allegiance to a land that's free.
Let us all be grateful.
Thank you, Sue. Thank you, Ken, for playing that and singing. Thanks, Jim. Took us down the memory lane there of hearing that. There was a couple of those I hadn't heard in a while. I really appreciate that. We were talking last week about Jesus saying, I am the way and the truth and the life. And so, naturally, we're going to go from the way to the truth and find out and get a little bit more into the truth. The truth is something that is hard. It's difficult. And when it is paired with something else, it often becomes something that we really have a hard time understanding. And that's, in this instance, we're on the 4th of July, so we're talking about freedom, right? And true freedom, being truly free. Now, that's something that we try to understand from an early age. Take yourself back with me on the Wayback Machine for some of you. I won't say for some of you on the Wayback Machine. But, you know, we're going back just a little bit. And remember when you were younger, when you were a kid. And one of the first lessons that you were probably taught by a parent or a grandparent, a teacher, maybe somebody that was there and trying to teach you some things about life was, tell the truth, right? We're told to tell the truth from an early age. There's no other times, really, that parents come in and say, all right, kids, now, this is what we're made of in this family. We want you to lie and lie your pants off, right? Liar, liar, pants on fire, you get it? All right, see? But you've got to understand that when we're younger, we are told to tell the truth. Now, here's the other part related to that. When we're younger, we don't really feel very free sometimes as we get older, do we? Because then the other coin of that is our parents say to us, or our grandparents, or whoever is watching us and being a part of our lives, our guardians, they say, step back from that road. Don't go there. Don't do this. Don't do that. My wife and I were watching a movie with my daughter a couple weeks ago. I think it was on Netflix, and it was called Yes Day. Anybody ever seen that one? And it's a family that said too much no, the kids felt. And so the kids had asked the mom and the dad to have a day of yeses. And so there were certain parameters that they did. But when the kids asked them to go do something, they had to say yes, unless it was something terrible. Well, that's good, right? Because it gives the kids a little bit of freedom. And when we're younger and we're growing up, when we put the truth together with freedom, who knows what will happen? Now, I told you to go on that Wayback Machine. Now, say this. I told you last week a little bit about my family, and my oldest daughter is Alex, and she's 23 years old, lives in the Hilliard and London area. Her husband's a policeman, and she works in a church. And when she was three and a half years old, we lived in Washington Courthouse, Ohio, and it was my first appointment that I'd had. And my primary responsibility then was taking a youth program that had used to be lots and lots of kids and bringing those kids back into that program. And so one of the ways my wife and I did that is we often every Wednesday night had a group that met at our house. And so we got to know the high school kids really well and junior high kids and spent time with them. And I'm getting to this, that we found that in order for a kid to really understand about the Bible and the truth that Jesus wants us to understand, is you had to go to some of their activities that they had, right? And I love to do that. So we'd go to the recitals, we'd go to the band things, we'd go to the sports things, we'd go to the art things, whatever it was. And so on a Friday evening there in Washington Courthouse, we were doing what most small towns in Ohio do and going to the football game. And Alex was three and a half, thereabouts. We'd been there about 3 years. She was 6 months or so when we got there. And she loved a lot of the youth kids, as she would call them, because they were so big and tall and did things, you know, and then they got down on their knees and played with her or played dolls or dress up or whatever. And so on this evening, she's in the stroller, I'm pushing the stroller, and my wife had caught some people from church that she was standing and talking to, and so I'd gone on a little bit further, and I was standing up against the fence that surrounds the football field talking to a few people myself. And one of our senior teenagers, who we'd spent a lot of time with in the last few years, came up and said, could we take Alex from you for a little bit and take her up in the stands? And I said, sure, I guess you can do that. And so they popped her out of her stroller and carried her and took her up there. Well, after a few minutes, I'd kind of forgotten what had happened and was watching the game. It was actually a very interesting one. And my wife got done talking, and she came over, and she said, where's Alex? And I said, I don't know. I said, she's up there in the stand somewhere. And she said, with who? And I said, well, with Amanda. Amanda took her up there. And so we're scanning the crowd, and we finally get down to the end in the student section, and there's about 150 kids there, and they're all dressed up and painted up for the football game. And we look, and on the top row of the bleachers getting ready to head down is my 3.5-year-old daughter. Her back of her head is facing me. Her feet are up in the air. And she's like this, crowd surfing, and they're passing her over her hands all the way down to the front. Now, if you ask her when she comes, she'll say she doesn't remember this, and this was before I had a cell phone in order to take a picture, you know, but that's what she was doing. All I could see was her face, because she's leaning back this way. Sorry, Caitlin, I'm not very flexible. I can't do that. But and she's got this big laughing smile on her face, and she's being passed up high from hand to hand. Now, I thought it was kind of funny. My wife, on the other hand, did not. And on the other hand, Amanda did not get to take Alex at a football game for a while. But Alex was experiencing some freedom, and as she got closer to us, we actually could hear her, even though people were cheering, and she was going, "Wee!" you know, just because it was fun. And that's what we learn when we're younger. We learn about truth, and we learn about being free and getting some freedom of choice. The truth, though, we're told, is not always things that we can handle, right? You remember the movie? You can't handle the truth, right? And there's all this life about truth and what is true and what isn't. In fact, we live in a day and age where it's hard sometimes to tell the difference between what is true and what is not true. And so you've got these two things. Truth sometimes is things that we can't always handle because we've kind of gone away from it. And freedom, that's something that Americans get behind, or at least we say we do. We rejoice in the notion of freedom. We teach about it. We say we live in this free country, and we have freedom of speech and freedom of religion and freedom of the press, freedom to bear arms, and all those things, you know, in the Constitution that we look at and we know and we try to learn about. But too many of us think that we understand freedom more than others, because we say that true freedom is really being able to do whatever you want, right? Now, I'm not picking on the younger generation, but they've really gotten into that, because they say, you're infringing upon my truths, and so this is what I'm going to do. And we have this constant pulling back, right? Because some of the older generation, we grew up, and some of us, and some of you that are even older than me, you grew up saying, you tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and that's what you do. But the true freedom for other generations often is it's my ability to choose, and I'll do what I want to do, right? It's almost like the little 3-4-year-old in your house that says, no. Go clean your room. No. Go do this. No. And you got to figure out how to get that word and change it to yes. And so it's this constant pulling back and forth. And what's happened is the truth has been stretched, freedom has been stretched, and neither of them really mean what they used to mean. Well, now, last week, we talked about Jesus saying, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And so he's trying to tell this truth, and we studied that last week about what it means to be the way. But what about when he says, I am not only the way, but I am the truth? Well, actually, what he's getting at is something that they had a hard time wrapping their heads around. And so before we go to the scripture for this morning, I have another one for you. It's not up on the screen because I want you to just listen for just a second. Because we know that truth comes from the freedom to choose. And so what John is teaching them in the scripture that we read last week and the one we're going to read in a few moments is he's teaching them the new covenant. Well, if you go to some of Paul's teachings, he's piggybacking off of this new covenant idea. But it was difficult, though, for the people because they were still wrapped up in the old covenant. Now, you know what the old covenant was? Many of you know, right? It was the Ten Commandments. It was the laws and the letter of the law. You followed the laws of the land, you followed the Ten Commandments, and you followed that letter as best you could. Well, the new covenant is something a little bit different. And so Paul was trying to teach them it's not that the letter of the law is bad. It's just that it is something that just leads to you being a good person and doing the things you can do. And then eventually you die and that's it. And if you believed and did those, follow those things, then you were told that you were a good and faithful servant. But what is the new covenant? Well, the new covenant is what the New Testament is trying to get us to understand. It's the pairing of the old versus the new. James actually says it's a believing, seeing, and doing kind of all in seamless unity. And so this is what Paul's trying to teach them. And he says to them, now, if that first ministry, the letter of the law, brought death, then will not the spirit law be something different? Because what he's saying to them is what he has to teach. Because remember what Jesus had said just a while before that. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. And then he said, but I'm leaving you for a little bit now, and in my place I will leave the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit is an important thing, entity, being, because the Holy Spirit is what comes and on upon us and gives us that new covenant and that ability to be different. Now, they had a really hard time understanding that, right? I've tried to explain it here, and it's a little difficult, but it's understandable. But for them, it was even harder because of this. When Moses was teaching them and showing them the Ten Commandments, he did something that he thought that he needed to do. Does anybody know what that was? Do you remember? He covered his face with a veil, right? Because he knew that God was giving him this message. And if you looked at his face, basically what had happened then is, you remember, God came in the form of the fire and the cloud and all those different things. And so if they saw and looked upon his face, they would see God, which is not something that they could do, and they'd see that glory, and they weren't allowed to do that, right? They lived in a time and a period where the high priest, even the preacher, could only go into that special part of the temple where the ark was one time each year. So they understood this veil part and the old covenant. Moses covered his face and he would teach them because he didn't even want them to see the receding of God as the message was done. And that's what they were used to. But now they're being told by John, by Paul, and by Jesus, right? Not the Beatles, John, Paul, and Ringo, and all the others. But they're being told something different. And they're trying to grasp their heads around it because for years and years they were told the veil covers the face because you can't see God. You can't talk to God. But now they're saying, no, here's a new truth. And Jesus had already come and he had said, I am the way and I am the truth and I'm the life. And you can't go to see God without me. And they said, wait a minute, I thought we needed a veil. You know, I thought we needed to keep ourselves from God. And Jesus said, no, because if you believe in me, you will believe also in my Father. And if you have the faith in me, then you should have the faith in him. So in other words, the old covenant, condemnation, admonishment, finger pointing, judgment. The new covenant, joined together with it, making you right with God so you can have that glorious moment to pray and speak with him. Old covenant, it was temporary. It was just about life, right? But the new covenant, Jesus was saying to them through John and Paul, it's eternal. If only you believe. All right, now that you've got that background, here is what we look at in John this morning. It's going to be up on the screen. Keep those things in your head about the veil and all that other stuff. Because here right off is what John writes to them in John 8, beginning with verse 31. To the Jews who had believed in him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And they answered him, we're Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we'll be set free? And Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave. Would you hold it right there for just a second? So he's telling them and he's saying to them, you think you know, but you don't have any idea, right? And really what it is all this time that you thought you were having true freedom through the letter of the law, you were really the same as always, because the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, so you're still a slave to sin. And that's what salvation brings. And so Jesus is trying to teach them that. And then after he leaves, John is trying to repeat that. Paul is trying to share that. They're all trying to tell you this, that in order to find truth and freedom, you have to know, first and foremost, that you're coming from something that you don't think that you are. You're a slave to sin. To them, when they heard that word, all they thought of was being a slave and being shackled and having to do what they were told. But really, it's more of a thing in life that we can't see. Our bodies, our minds are often just having problems. And Jesus is saying to them, listen to me. Here's more of what I have to tell you. You can go on to the next one now. Now, a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's descendants, yet you are looking for a way to kill me because you have no room for my word. And stop right there. You can leave it on that one for a second. Now he's saying to them, I know what you're saying about Abraham, because Abraham, well, he was mine too. And what did I tell him to do? He's trying to remind them. He understood the new covenant because God said what? Go and take your son. He did it, didn't he? He said, go and take him, put him on that altar, and sacrifice him for your sins for me. And Abraham was going to do it. But then God said to him, no, you understand. Abraham was moving past the old covenant into the new. He wasn't worried about the chains of life. He was worried about the wonder of heaven. And so Jesus is saying to them, I'm telling you what I have seen in the Father's presence. And you are doing what you have heard from your Father. Notice there's a capital F there, and then there's a small f. Because the capital is God, the small f is our own mortal fathers, right? And all they did was teach us the letter of the law just like they were taught when they were little. But yet there's more to life and more to it than that. All right, go on to the next one. Abraham is our father, they answered. If you were Abraham's children, said Jesus, then you would do what Abraham did. Well, we know Abraham's their father because what are the songs that we sing when we're a kid? Father Abraham had many sons. You know, it's like this little exercise song. My two youngest are down in Myrtle Beach, and it was, this is a side note, sorry, my ADD's kicking in. But they're down in Myrtle Beach with my parents, which I'm going to have to go get them here if I ever get moved. And my youngest had called me, Jackson, the other day, and as he was on the phone, it was about 11 in the morning, 11:15, and I heard this. And I was like, what are you doing already this morning that you're breathing heavy? He's like, well, Dad, I was just at Bible school, and it was a real physical Bible school sing-along. And I was like, what? And he's like, we were doing all those hard ones, you know, like Father Abraham and all. And he was naming off all the songs that you got to do the motions to. And apparently the Bible school that he was in had really done him heavy duty because he was wore out. This is the 12-year-old video game world that we're living in here, right? Even Jackson knew. Father Abraham, he had many sons. Had many sons, had Father Abraham. And they did what they were told because they knew what Abraham wanted. But here, even Abraham knew that he was not the buck because it didn't stop with him. It stopped with his heavenly father. As it is, you're looking for a way to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. You are doing the works of your own father, small f. We are not illegitimate children, they protested. The only father we have is God himself. Now here they're starting to get the picture a little bit. So they're saying, hey, you know, our father is still like what you're saying, our father in heaven. But Jesus says to them, if God were truly your father, you would love me, for I have come here from God, and I have not come on my own. God sent me. Why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. Now, before we get to this last part here, those in this old covenant, new covenant time must have had a lot of earwax problems, right? They weren't trying those new products. They didn't have Q-tips. They didn't have all those different things, you know, that we have. Because how many times does Jesus say to them, you don't know what you're doing because you're not hearing me, right? He must be looking at them and saying, you know, I'll flash back again to my age, one of my favorite movies. Hello, McFly, right? Back to the Future. And he's saying to them, you've got to know, you've got to understand that what you think is true, it's all different. Believe in me. And he says, you belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. And when he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Yet because I tell the truth, you don't believe me. Can any of you prove me guilty of sin? If I'm telling the truth, why don't you believe me? Whoever belongs to God, here's what God says. The reason you do not hear is that you do not belong to God. Now leave that one up here. This one's a really important one, okay? This is that last verse here. I want you to say it with me, all right? Whoever belongs to God, here's what God says. The reason you do not hear is that you do not belong to God. Now, I did that because we all learn in different ways, right? Some of us learn from hearing. Some of us learn from seeing. You know, watch the little dancing monkey preacher up here, and I'll teach you what to do and how to grow and all those things. But some of you, you've got to read it for yourself to understand it. And here is what it is. Jesus is laying it out for you, and he's saying, whoever belongs to God, here's what God says. The reason you don't hear is that you don't belong to God. Now, I don't know about you, but I hear that, and that scares me. Because there are even times in my life, your preacher, where I get upset with life and the truths that I think are supposed to happen, which is this, right? I know that I've been in the Methodist church my entire life. I'm 49, going to be 50 in November. My father was a 40-year United Methodist minister. I know how the system works. Whenever the district superintendents and the bishop appoint you to a church, you move to that church. You don't sit at home among boxes for 2 weeks and then move, right? I know the truths, but the truths don't always happen the way we want, right? Because we're just a slave to sin. And I'm not saying that somebody's sinning because they're not moving. I'm saying that sometimes stuff happens. And sometimes it's more difficult than just living in boxes for 3 or 4 weeks. Some of us are going through such difficult things in life, and we're wanting to hold on to a covenant that's still important, the truth of the commandments of what God gives us, but we're missing that new covenant. And it's so scary that Jesus had to say that. He's talking to the disciples, to those who are right there with him. Think about this. They have Jesus right in front of them, and he's saying, if you want to know the truth, why don't you believe in me? And so he has to tell them because they don't even understand right with him. And he says, if you belong to God and hear what he says, the reason you don't hear is maybe you don't belong. Now, I don't know about you, but I would say that everyone in here, the reason that you're coming to church is because you feel you belong to God, right? Amen? And not only that, but you feel like when the time is done and you are passing on from this earth, that you're going to go someplace important, right? Now, if you are here this morning as a visitor or don't know about that or believe that, please ask questions. Ask of someone sitting near you. Ask of myself. Because I can tell you this, the new covenant is that if you believe, you will go to that next place. But you have to hear what God says. And true freedom, that's what God has for you and for me. And so on this 4th of July, as we celebrate the freedom of just knowing the world that we live in, remember that. Remember this saying: truth does not mind being questioned. A lie doesn't like to be challenged. My grandma used to say that. And it was a smart saying because it was saying this: something that's really true, you just know it and you don't really have to make much questioning. But we do anyways because we're human and we're people. But a lie from the father of lies, the devil himself, he can't stand being challenged. And so I look to you this morning and say this: know the truth. Because the Spirit of truth is so glorious that Christ wants to look to you and come individually to each of you and lift the veil, so that you can see the glory that was given from you from the beginning. And it's fitting that today we celebrate that. We celebrate that by sharing in Holy Communion. Now, I know it's not the way that we can normally do it, and we have to use the little cups and things, but it's still the same in our hearts. And Jesus took the bread, and he broke it. And he said, this is my body, broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me. So when you get the wafer there, sorry, I'm cheating. In the first service, I couldn't get mine open, so Kathy nicely opened mine for me. If you need help, let someone know. Take and eat in remembrance of him. Him who died on the cross for the forgiveness of your sins and mine. Then Jesus took the cup and he said, this is my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink from it, remember me. The blood of Christ. So what is the truth? The truth is this: Jesus loves you so much He loves all his children. And that's what we are, a child of God. But in order to belong, folks, we've got to hear him and hear what he has for us. So I ask you this. We're going to sing our closing hymn in just a moment. And as we do, think to yourself, do I understand and know what Jesus is trying to tell me, that new covenant that's in my life? Do I understand that I have to hear him to belong to him? Do I hear him? Do I need a good old-fashioned ear cleaning, or do I need more of the Spirit in my life? Well, if you do need that, this prayer is for you. Heavenly Father, I ask that as we ready ourselves to sing and then go from this place on this beautiful day of freedom, may we not feel those shackles of sin, but may we feel the truth, and may that truth set us free. Because truly, if we believe and we hear you, we're already free. So I ask, Father, for each person this morning making that choice and commitment to be more about you, may they feel that wondrous sense, that glorious sense of freedom. May the veil be lifted from their face, and may they look upon themselves in their heart, the others around them, and see God, and then follow him. Because you are the truth. And oh, Father, do we need set free. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. As we sing that closing hymn, if you are one of those that were praying for that this morning, you don't have to do anything special. I'm not going to ask you to come up to the front. You can always if you want to. It's always open. You can pray from your seat. You can catch me as you're leaving and say, hey, John, will you pray for me this week? I want to be set free. Just make sure to tell me your name so I don't have to just remember a face. And know this. You're in the right place. Church isn't for the perfect, right? It's a MASH unit for those that need some help. And we're all here and in this together.
If you're able, please stand for the closing hymn, Oh How I Love Jesus, verses 1, 2, and 3, and you can find that in your hymnal on page 170.
Feel my tears.
As you go from this place, may you go with the God of peace and take him to all that you meet. Happy 4th of July, and it was good to see you this morning. Thank you.